Welcome back again. This is Radio Free Canada. Hi there, I'm Darren Howard.
The Reverend Earl.
And Neil Magnusen from the Freedom Tour.
We're on Radio Free Canada right now with a very special show because we're talking about law enforcement against prohibition. It's an excellent subject. It's something that you want to get into. And if you're near a computer, L-E-A-P, make sure you get your search engine going on this. The official part of the program to start things off right now. Remember, everything that we do is protected under Section 2 of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Stephen Harper can kiss my butt. And every piece of media that we use is used under international fair usage guidelines as far as copyright laws are concerned. This is a revolution. A conscious revolution is occurring everywhere, and we are part of that revolution. One thing that we're talking about?
We're going to talk about some patient rights when it comes to the medicine called marijuana.
Yes, patient rights is very important. What else are we going to talk about?
Well, freedom when it comes to using that medicine.
Yeah, freedom is something we love talking about, and it's really interesting, too. We're going to run just about 30 seconds of background right now, and we're going to be right back again. We've got Neil and Earl in the studio with a very special edition of Radio Free Canada. We'll be right back after this. It's an excellent day to be in the Okanagan right now. Radio Free Canada, welcome back again, and it's really good to have you a part of things. Remember, everything that you're going to hear is just our opinion, and it's only our opinion. It's protected by law, so do not go and jump off a bridge if you hear something that offends you. Please, don't do that. Safety tip. Kids out there just take it too seriously, and that's a bad thing. And also, if you're an in-the-box thinker, beware. Spoiler alert, we are not in-the-box thinkers. If you think Walmart profiting from Chinese slave labor is cool, please stop listening now. Okay? CHBC is not the news. McDonald's is not a restaurant. We have that opinion, and if that offends you, we want you to tune out because we're going to talk about the one thing, one of those things that really makes the conservatives crawl, and that's legalizing it. Okay, let's get right into it. Let's talk about legalizing marijuana. I'm going to ask the question, 30-second question right now. Okay, Neil. Neil Magnusen, you're on tour right now. First of all, let's give a little bit of background on the tour. What got you on tour? What was your motivation there?
2004, started helping out with the pot rallies. I'd been doing that a couple years before that, but really got involved at that point. Pot legalization for me turned into an issue of freedom. The stuff I was doing in Vancouver, I had to do across the country, and I ended up going on tour called the Freedom Tour back in 2006, where I spent 5 months on the road going from Victoria to Ottawa for Remembrance Day. I inline skated over 1,000 miles that year and 1,000 miles the next 2 years as well, like 3,000 in total. And that was to get the media to pay attention to the message. And the message is four basic things all about freedom. Freedom is the right to do or not do whatever you want to do unless you are harming somebody else.
3,000 miles. Now, I'm sorry. I'm just going to say that straight out. 3,000 miles inline skating?
Yes, sir, on the highways of Canada.
Now, so we got you on here on Saturday, okay? It was on, what was it, the 16th?
The 14th.
The 14th.
For our rally in March.
No news shows up. There's no news camera there. We did the news to let the news know what was going on.
Right.
And so, and they don't even know you inline skated for 3,000 miles to bring some awareness to the ludicrous prohibition situation.
That's right. You know, the first thing is what freedom is. The second thing was what the rule of government is. The third thing is the dangers and the costs of prohibition. And the fourth thing is the value of cannabis and hemp. And cannabis and hemp prohibition is our lead issue because that's the most glaring and ludicrous example of how we are not free here.
Okay, so just to interject really quickly, the Union. Okay, make sure you watch that.
It's a damn good movie, yes.
Trip is a BC
still
production.
Tripping.
Still Tripping's coming out yet, but you can go watch the trailers at stilltrippingmovie.com.
Okay, and start doing the pharmaceutical industry, right? Start looking at the marijuana and the pharmaceutical industry that's out there, because there's another angle, and we're going to get and talk about that. Okay, yes. Talk about what the medical industry is.
The patients need their meds, and they're not getting them.
Yeah.
It's hard to get them in Canada.
And for us right now we do. This is a long format program right now, but we're going to be right back. We're going to take a quick 2-minute break right now for those people who have to catch up. So we're going to let them catch back, and we're going to be back with Neil Magnusen. 2 minutes. Back again. It's we're talking about those good old radio days, okay, way back when. And the amazing part about society today, we can do this stuff, and that we can do this out of your house. And we're really encouraging everyone out there, go and get yourself a microphone. You got a computer, start your own radio station. Get out there so we can get off the air, by the way, you know, because
yeah, you don't want to listen to us anyway. What just the puppy talk.
Yeah, I mean, come on, really. I mean, well, you could get some informed opinions going.
I could be sitting at home. I don't have to be doing this. Somebody else should be doing this.
This is one of, you know what? You just hit one of those things. Okay. I didn't want to get off the couch and go and deal with this. Okay. And this was my statement to the cops about police brutality. It's not the fact that you guys are really acting like jerks or you can't grow up and get a good training. It's the fact that I have to get off my couch and explain it. How does that make you feel? I mean, doesn't it get frustrating?
I'm getting old. I mean, I'd kind of like to go retire in some nice place, but we can't because it's serious, you know? And if we don't do what we need to do, then the next generation's screwed here. So.
Yeah, and they'll have to fight anyway. I mean, so we may as well get the fight over with now and get everybody calmed down and see some sense and get some sense going on.
Yeah.
So it's even easier for our kids to just, you know, settle into a life like we all imagined.
If we wake up, realize we're on a couch, get off the couch and do something quick.
maybe
our kids and our grandkids won't be so pissed at us later on down the road somewhere. You know?
Yeah. And the guys we hire will start doing what we're hiring them to do instead of whatever they want.
But this is my statement is solve the problem right now because we need the economy. Okay, the economy's got to get rocking. We're going into this artificial recession. They're creating an artificial recession right now around the world, and we need an influx of cash. We had Burma, I think it was, who legalized it strictly for the export capabilities, and they knew that they could do it. They jumped on the wagon way before.
Yeah, well, they've been saying for years that the whole system is unsustainable, and now we're finding out what that actually means. That now the economy's in the tank, and why? Well, we're spending a whole whack of our resources to protect corporate interests in the name of drug prohibition.
Yeah.
Sure. 72% of all court cases in 2010 were drug-related in Canada. I mean, you know...
Is that right? 72%?
You know, in the categories of things that court cases could be about, nothing should be more than about 15%, you know? I mean, when something's up there at like 72%, what the hell's going on with that, you know?
Okay, now, so I'm talking to Stockwell Day when the police brutality issue was out there, and I told him, look, 25% of our GDP is court costs.
Wow.
Okay? Wow. That's now you're talking about the criminal statistics, so I'd have to look at what... how much of the court cost is criminal statistics. Right. But I was floored. I asked him, I said, did you know that stat? And he kind of looked at the ground and goes, yeah.
Yeah, man.
And I said, our GDP is related to the court system? And that's our taxpayer money, okay? Because every time you're in court, that's our money.
And there's a lot of it going on there. I mean, everybody's being paid in the room, eh? The judge, the sheriff, the stenographer, the prosecutor.
Yeah.
Everybody's getting paid, usually off of our dime. They got lights like crazy. You go into those courtrooms, look at all the lights, and just think about all those lights burning all day long in all those courtrooms, you know? That's expensive.
Yeah.
And the woodworking involved and all the rest of it. It's a huge machine, and it needs to keep on having stuff to chew up and spit out, because that's what its job is. So the police are the frontline salespeople, if you will. They're bringing in all the customers for the court system to process, and they need to have an X amount of people coming through all the time. They got to keep that going, because the courts need to have as many people as they can, or as many people as they need to process to fill the prisons that they have to keep all those people working. And so they have to have these drug
laws. So if we legalize it,
they're taking
a hit.
Yeah,
we've got this crazy omnibus crime bill.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I mean, come on.
That's going to fill some prisons.
They're saying that, you know, things like the shooting in Toronto, okay, you know, when it came out and there's the shooting, it hits the front lines. And well, we put our omnibus crime bill and this is what it's going to address.
Yeah, that won't happen anymore, right?
That's it.
They put up the omnibus crime bill, that'll stop it.
Yeah, for sure.
No more gangland shooting, man. Those guys are going to say, hey, enough of this now. There's an omnibus crime bill.
Yeah, you might go to jail if you're a gangster, and that's going to stop them.
Yeah, man.
So now if we lose 72% of our court cases, okay, off of this, have you thought about what are we going to do with the guys who are in jail for offenses that are suddenly...
We should not be using our taxpayers' dollars to keep people in prison and in cages unless they're violent. You know, what are we doing putting human beings into cages for? I mean, and they do it like it's just commonplace. Like, no problem. Yeah, you just put you in jail, man. You owe money, you're going to jail. You didn't pay your fine, you're going to jail. You know, you're smoking some weed, you're going to jail. What?
Yeah. Have a cigarette in public. Oh, you're going to jail.
I mean... What? Yeah. What are people in cages?
And this is a civilization.
Oh, man, yeah.
You know, you're a civilization, okay? Oh, and you talk to senior citizens out there, and they say, we should bring the cane back in the jail. And if we could beat these guys when they're in jail, then they would have less of a...
They'd come out good citizens if we did that.
That's the answer, eh? It's like, if our parents had dropped us on our head more, we would have got it long ago, yeah.
Right.
That doesn't make sense.
Okay. Now, but they'd point at places like Japan that's got a wicked, legal system. You go to jail in Japan, you're going to jail. You sit in the center of the room on your knees all day. You literally get bread and water. This is for real, okay? Wow. And they say, well, we should bring that kind of corporal punishment in.
Yes, but here in Canada, we're doing it more like the Chinese example, where if you're an activist, you end up being the guy in jail. So there you are smoking a joint 1 minute and you're in prison the next.
In Canada, you're smoking a joint 1 minute and you're in handcuffs the next.
That's what I'm saying. So we're following that example, not Japanese model where they're actually building a system that works and punishes people for hurting people and stuff.
I'm going to challenge you for a second here, though, okay? Because there's a mandate within the RCMP locally and with City Hall not to bust the common guy smoking a joint.
Good.
Okay, and they're saying straight out that we're not enforcing at that level. Because we don't care that much. We want to put our resources towards grow ops and gangsters.
Well, I hope they keep that up, because I as a guy who hangs in the streets here in Kelowna, I still see the fines that come out of their efforts.
Okay.
So any expenditure of public money in pursuit of cannabis consumers is a criminal misuse of public funds.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I get you.
Especially after all the experts are now weighing in. But we've known this for a long time anyway, since the 2002 Senate, but probably since 1969 and the Ladain Commission.
Yes.
But now we've got, here in British Columbia, 8 sitting mayors that have written an open letter to the federal government, to the provincial government, saying we have to end the prohibition. Mm-hmm. We've got the 4 previous attorney generals that are saying the case against prohibition is airtight. And these are people who choose their words very carefully.
Yeah.
And then there's the United Nations of all groups that have come out with the Vienna Declaration. They went worldwide with conferences looking for the unintended consequences of prohibition, and found that they were vast and there are many. It's costing us $1 billion+ every year, and really we're not putting a dent in the supply and demand.
Okay, you're hitting it right on the money. We've seen an accelerated amount of supply. Okay, we had a couple $1 billion 5 years ago. Now we're up to $7 billion a year.
In BC.
No, you've been coast to coast. What are we looking at in Ottawa, Alberta? I mean, do you know what output is? Manitoba, I know is raking it out.
Sure.
They're competing with us now.
Well, and Saskatchewan's got lots of stuff going on. Lots of cannabis is actually being grown in Saskatchewan. Ontario for sure is growing lots of cannabis. Quebec, they've always been a leader, really. You know?
They've got to be.
Sure. So $9 billion in BC, I mean, you could quadruple that, or maybe it's 10 times that all across Canada. Maybe eight times.
Ontario is going to be at least 10 times what BC is. It's
because the population alone, you would have to assume that you'd have a similar saturation, if not more, because you have more happening. That means more creates bigger.
They know in the United States that the whole cannabis industry is bigger than their next top two industries put together, which is corn and wheat. Bigger than both of those put together.
Is that for real?
And it's enough to pay for a war, man.
And it's all underground. And even those figures, you know, hard to know if they're accurate, because who's going to admit that they're growing weed or selling weed or using weed, right?
Then there's the other thing, too, the hard statistic. Okay, well, if I bust somebody with an ounce of weed, they're going to calculate the amount of cost based on per gram sale. And I looked at that and I said, no, because if I'm buying 10 pounds of it, I'm getting a markdown just like Walmart.
You're getting a good price, yes.
Oh, okay.
Man, you can't trust their stats. I mean, they've been lying to us for decades and decades. Yeah. And, you know, they have their interests to protect. That's why when people aren't telling the truth, it's always because they've got some of their own interests going on there and they're trying to protect those. That's why we've been lied to for so long by those people who control the media and who have leverage to use against our governments that get their interests protected at our costs. Yep. And
Okay,
you know,
let's dwell on that.
And then other people line up to join them and use their leverage in the same manner and help manipulate the society even further. And then you end up with patients ending up in jail who have been guaranteed by the government the right to have their meds, et cetera. And it just gets even more convoluted. I mean, really. So all the way around, it's a waste of all kinds of money.
But the debate is carried on major media. And you mentioned that, you know, that major media is not carrying the story.
Well, it's changing a bit for sure. You know, as you look at the stories coming across, it is changing.
The union goes and gets aired in Ottawa.
They didn't carry it for years and years. You would only get the horror stories, and they were all made up and bullshit.
Like marijuana madness. If there was a good story,
it would run right beside a story where they were blaming marijuana for some violence in our society or something like that. Or they would put it right beside, you know, gangsters caught with marijuana and guns, you know. And so they buried these stories. Now it's getting a little better, although I think the media is still controlled by these forces, but it's just too much to keep down now. I mean, it's such a huge, huge story. I mean, this is really, really serious here.
Yeah.
You know, because we've got these experts now saying that prohibition much then with the mayors. Yeah. We got the AG saying that the case is airtight against prohibition. Yeah. We've got the United Nations coming out and saying there's a huge amount of unintended consequences, like disrespect for the police, organized criminal gangs. The money we spend doesn't address the drug abuse issue. It exacerbates it, increases demand, guarantees an unregulated black market. So it's something you can't keep down very easily right now. But further to that, we've got the 2002 Senate who went and looked into this and found out all of these things 10 years ago and published those results. So now it becomes criminal. Now our federal government is involved in a criminal conspiracy to protect the interests of these lobbyists or the agents of those with leverage who want their interests protected. And we can see that now, and everybody can see that clearly now. So our police have to act on this.
Yeah.
You know.
And we're going to take a quick 2-minute break just for everybody else to catch up here. And I'm going to come back with that, and we're going to start talking about the union and the way the conspiracy really works. And it is good. You got to remember, the revolution's occurring. People are waking up everywhere. So be happy, enjoy your life, and remember, we're winning. We're going to be right back. 2 minutes.
Yeah.
We're back. It's a great day right here. The weather is what it is, and the weather is what it is where you are. Make sure you make time to make signs, get out in the street, but above all, get informed and question us on what we're talking about. Because if you don't ask questions, we don't have answers. Okay, we are here with Neil Magnusen. It is Freedom Tour 2012, right?
You bet.
Okay.
Freedomtour.ca.
Freedomtour.ca, the man who's gone 3,000 kilometers on inline skates, which, ladies, he has to have rock-hard muscles to do that.
I haven't done it for 3 years, but I'm still buff, you know.
Oh, yeah.
But I have a girlfriend. I got to tell you that.
Okay.
Roxy, I love you, baby.
Hearts are breaking all over the internet everywhere. It is. We've got you on video, and you're talking, and you stand up, and you talk about the fact. One of the last comments we got, and we are going to put that one on YouTube, okay, when we filmed you down at Cary Park right here in Kelowna. So we're going to talk. What you finished off talking about was, well, society needs more rules because it's all about rules, right? Yeah. Apparently, if we don't have rules, it will be an unsafe society. Things will fall apart. You know, it's going to be the big thing.
Well, I mean, it's good to have some rules, and rules are actually born out of situations that arise, and somebody goes, oh, well, we need to have a rule to address that. Yeah. And that's why we've got the rules that we've got. I mean, every red light that you see out there in the city,
yeah,
that exists because somebody died at that
somebody
intersection.
Somebody got hurt.
Somebody, yeah.
No, no, not, not
or
just
a bunch
hurt.
Of people
somebody
got hurt.
Somebody has to die for an intersection to happen in a city most of the time.
Actually, because, that's true.
Yeah,
okay, we just ran a story on
do
that.
It. And if it's just people getting injured, they just put it off and put it off. Then somebody dies. They go, okay, we're getting the money for a light there. We got an intersection there. And so that's what they all represent is a place where eventually somebody died and then they made a rule and said, well, okay, well, now you should stop and wait for the other cars.
Now, I'm going to address this right away because it's interesting. I just got a story off of the internet about a community that had people getting hit, but nobody died. Okay, so it was a big problem within there.
Right.
So the city council is saying, look, if you're going to pony up to $50,000, and then get your taxes raised, we'll pay for it, and then the maintenance. And they said, no, you're the city. We want to do something.
Yeah.
A guy goes there, he gets fed up, and he paints a great big flower in the intersection.
Nice.
Okay? And then they put some murals up on the concrete surrounding the intersection. And then they put up little stands for lemonade stand and a vegetable stand, and they made it into a little square. After they got done doing all this, they had the whole community come together, and they had a party.
Right.
But what happened was, because there's a flower there and there's murals and there's a little kiosk set up, everybody slows down.
Nice.
They didn't need a light.
There
they didn't
go.
Need a rule.
There you
okay.
Go.
And you can track that down at Radio Free Canada on Facebook. We've got that on there. And then we're going to be putting that on the .org as soon as that's up and running September 15th. There are solutions that don't include rules.
Well, and all these rules that we've got in the books that are there because there was an incident that required some addressing and now we've got a rule.
Right.
I mean, that's all fine. But, you know, when those rules are now just enforced by the book because they're on the books and that incident is nowhere to be seen anymore and those problems aren't there, well, that's when it becomes a problem. And that's what a lot of that we've got going on right now.
Okay.
Where bylaws out there just giving tickets, you know, willy-nilly all over the place by the book. And really, there's not the interference going on that those bylaws were designed to try and stop. So there's some of that that needs to be redressed and looked at and scaled back. And a lot of our laws that are on the books right now, and there's just tons of them, they need to be looked at as well. You're not allowed to play three-card rummy on most street corners in Canada.
Here in town, I have no question about that. Stephen Fleming confirmed it for me, the head of the clerk's office. We have over 10,000 bylaws in Kelowna.
Wow.
10,000 bylaws.
Wow.
Now he says, well, these are like building permits and stuff like this. Come on. The number is 10,000.
Yeah.
Okay.
We need to arm our enforcement people with the guidelines and things that they can use to interfere with people who are interfering with people, because that's why we have bylaw people and enforcement people. But, you know, what it's become now is just a huge bureaucracy. It's a huge money-making scheme, and it's just a money grab from the government, you know, of the populace in, I don't know how many, 10,000 different ways that they can take money from you, you know.
Yeah.
And there's just fees and fines and levies and taxes and on it goes. And every time they find a new creative way to take some money from us, they do it, you know.
Yeah.
Like parking, meters, for example, drive me nuts. I mean, why do we got those for? What service are they providing to us by having those meters there? They don't come and wash your car. They're not there to make sure somebody doesn't break into it. I mean, what service are you getting?
Right.
They exist in Vancouver because some merchants were saying, hey, these cars are parked there all day and we can't have our customers parked there. But, you know, you don't need a parking meter to address that. You need a sign that says 1 or 2 hour maximum parking. Why they're taking money from the citizens for, you know, it's a multi-million dollar business in Vancouver to collect all this parking money and all the rest of it. For what? You know, what? Like I say, no service. It employs a bunch of people. That's kind of nice. We're paying a bunch of people so they can pay their mortgage, but we're not getting any service back for that at all. It's just money down the tube.
Okay, so we've got a court system, right? Okay, yes. And 72% are marijuana-related?
No, drug-related.
Drug-related.
The majority cannabis and the majority simple possession.
Is there a ratio there? Do you know how much is cannabis?
I can't give you the stats.
That's okay.
Yeah. No, but the majority of the drug convictions are for minor possession. That is a guarantee within those stats.
And the majority of drug cases are cannabis related, and that's quite a large majority.
Okay.
And it really shouldn't be. I mean, it's a waste all the way around with the taxpayers, the police being involved, all at that point.
We need to have legalization and regulation. We need to have legalization for every individual to be able to grow, consume, use, and share whatever they want. That we need to have regulations for whenever somebody wants to put up a shingle and sell to the public, and then make sure that there's whatever reasonable regulations make sense on
a
substance.
Okay, so kind of what you're saying is you want to go back to a farming model.
Well,
where I can farm and then I can sell.
Or well, whatever.
You know, if people want to farm and they want to sell commercially, then there should be regulations that guide that so that, you know, the public is as best protected as they can be from whatever it is we're talking about. In the case of cannabis, it would be age restrictions that would be reasonable. Some quality control testing or assurances might require some taxation, but not much more than that. Maybe some advertising restrictions, but you know, really the cannabis, you wouldn't want to tax it. Larry Campbell says tax the hell out of it, but you have to have justification for that. And when people are then going to be switching from alcohol, pharmaceuticals, and tobacco products to use what is now a legal cannabis supply, well, that's going to be a net benefit to our society to have those real harmful and dangerous drugs, you know, reduced in their usage and cannabis replacing it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great replacement substance for sure.
Way less drunken people down the street, and that would be awesome. That would be just one good thing to come out of the whole ending of prohibition.
The
legalization is definitely the go-to way. You know, it's like a tomato then. It's just, anybody can grow it.
The police in Vancouver have told me during the fireworks when there's a lot of alcohol-fueled incidents going on, they've said to me, I mean, officers have said to me, if we had cannabis in our society instead of alcohol, we wouldn't even have to be here. There would be no incidents.
Well, that's the whole thing. We got Vancouver riots, rye, dump a crap load of rye into a whole bunch of Canadians and give them a bad day.
Yeah.
Okay, we know what this is going to, you know how this is going to end up, kids. Yeah. Okay, and we've seen that, a direct correlation between alcohol and domestic violence, and we see the exact opposite. Now we've got the medicinal thing.
But no, let me go back for just a second
Go ahead.
Alcohol, you know, this is a big problem in our society in many ways, right? I mean, drinking and driving, domestic violence, numerous overdoses and other things going on with alcohol. Why, and yet you can't have a herb. Who makes the money on alcohol? It's not Al Capone anymore.
No.
When they ended alcohol prohibition, they took the distribution under the auspices of the government. They became the alcohol profiteers.
Right.
So this group that's making money off of alcohol doesn't want to admit to all the harms being caused by alcohol, wants to blame cannabis for the harms in society, doesn't want people growing their own recreational substance. Right. They want to be the suppliers. What's wrong with this picture here?
Uh-huh.
A monopoly by our government on a harmful substance, and they're using our tax dollars to put down a safer alternative? Wow. That's crazy, man.
That's it. When you say it all in one statement like that, it's like running and slamming your head against a cement wall.
Yeah. Or when you talk about how prohibition exacerbates drug abuse, increases demand, and guarantees an unregulated black market. All that billion of dollars, we're spending over $1 billion every year, according to the Stop the Violence people. We're getting zero benefit back from that. We're getting more problems. It's like going and paying somebody to punch you in the head.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. What are we spending? What result?
Yeah.
Do we get from any of this?
Gangs and disrespect for the police and no money left.
Okay. And we said with $7 billion, you could bust $1 million worth of grow up every day.
And you're like, you're still doing nothing.
Nothing. Nope.
You're like standing under Niagara Falls with a cup and telling people you're making a difference.
Yes, because every guy you grab, 10 other guys will replace him.
And there's going to be some fights involved in who gets that job.
Yeah, who's going to have that job?
Because if you cause a vacuum. I always raise the interesting point. You know, our mayor locally was, you know, we talked about how many grow-ops. One time there was an estimate there was 500 grow-ops here in town.
That they knew of.
That they knew of.
Yeah.
Okay, and let alone what they don't know about. Yeah. Okay, because it's got to be huge.
But they had identified 500 of them.
Right. Okay. What I said to him was, well, we've got some of the best engineers in the world working because we don't hear about fires.
Yeah. No fires.
No fires for years.
No, well, fires from cigarettes and cooking fires.
Yeah, cooking fire.
Yeah.
Okay.
Kitchen fires and cigarette fires.
Lighting her kitchen on fire or a guy falling asleep with a cigarette and a couch. Yeah.
That's 90% of all fires.
Okay. And then the
houses
very
aren't being condemned
rare
all the time.
Grow up. Okay. This is an engineering feat to face all engineering feats. Come on. Really, we've got hydraulic systems, you've got packaging supplies, we got warehouses built into the walls of canyons. Okay.
Pretty safe industry.
Amazingly safe.
No WorkSafe BC claims for the most part that I've heard about.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Okay. We don't have a safe job. Yeah.
Growing and tending to plants.
Yeah.
Packaging.
Okay. We don't
distribution.
See. Okay. Yeah. We've got all of those guys who are employed. And I said to one of the RCMP officers that we had a meeting on the side, and I said, it's got to be the number one employer.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. It's the number one crop that we produce, number one industry, so it's the number one employer.
It's got to be.
Yeah. That's a lot of scissors.
So if they shut...
Yeah, a lot of scissors. So the scissor companies are doing well. Invest in scissors.
Right on. Okay. But, you know, I said that. I said to him, I went, my argument is jobs. We need jobs. Now, all of a sudden, we're into a position where these employees, one of our largest employer, would be getting benefits, some insurance protection. You might be able to go in. You got to hire more inspectors for the engineering end of it. But we do have to learn this super high-quality way that they're doing things.
Safe, safe, safe.
Yes.
Yeah. They've got it down to a science.
Well,
we need to learn
another
this.
One of these contradictions in what we're trying to achieve here. We are spending money to have policemen go in and shut down grow ops, and they're actually just putting people out of work that were paying their rent.
Yes, and we want corporations that use best manufacturing processes, and here we have them, and we're shutting them down.
And we're shutting them down.
Yeah.
Just because the plant might be illegal. Well, and at the same time, we have science saying, this is looking more and more like a very beneficial and efficacious medicinal plant for people that may be the missing link for us in a lot of ways.
But
controversy just keeps building around it. It's a waste all the way.
Now these are the arguments that we hear. Negative effects on society, bad health risks, and unproven science. Okay, this is what I get back all the time. First of all, you got a bunch of potheads who are too lazy to get off the couch.
Oh, come on.
$7 billion industry, biggest industry in the province. You know, who's lazy?
The architects, the dentists, the construction workers, the taxi drivers. I mean, all these people that are working out there are also consuming cannabis, you know.
Yes.
I mean, Health Canada says that of the people that are consuming cannabis in Canada, about 3-7% could be considered to be abusing it, which would be the ones that are smoking too much and now they're not doing their chores, you know, or something like that.
Okay.
3-7%. So 93-97% of people that are consuming cannabis are not abusing it. They're deriving a benefit by...
This is a Health Canada statistic?
This is Health Canada says that, yeah.
And okay,
they also say that there's 1.5 to 2 million Canadians that could use the program and would use it if they could use it, but they just can't seem to get access to it because of its flaws.
Well, we had the active RCMP turning away all applications for growing, all applications, you know, for criminal record checks, just abjectly. They were supposed to supply them. They said, no, we're not.
Yeah.
And then as soon as it was revealed in the news, they said, oh, well, we're going to do it now.
Yeah.
Okay, and they went with it.
If the flaws are obvious, we've only got about 17,000 people in Canada that have exemptions at this point from Health Canada, and you know there's a lot more than that would like to have a piece of paper that would keep them from getting arrested.
Okay.
But, you know, they're afraid to go to their doctor, or their doctor won't help them, or they don't want their name on a list somewhere, because who knows, if the situation turns, now all of a sudden they're going to be a criminal again. There's just a lot of reasons why people aren't accessing this program. But the bottom line is that there's 1.5 million to 2 million Canadians, by Health Canada's own estimate, that would be exempt from the law if they could just use the program. And so our police are out there still chasing these people that, you know, aren't criminals, would be exempt from the law. And when they get to court, if they get arrested and charged and it proceeds to court, and then they come up with a doctor's note that, that confirms a diagnosis, it gets thrown out of court. It's a waste of our court time, a waste of all the police time, a waste of their time. Why are we doing this? I mean, what, this is crazy. A crime is supposed to be when you intentionally cause harm to somebody else, not when you got possession of some plant material that you thought might help you feel better, and you don't respect the government laws because you know they don't respect you, and you know they're in bed with the corporations.
That's a really good statement. I'm going to keep that one for a second because the law doesn't respect you.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. I mean, you're standing there in court, and in the end, you're the one being punished. When really it's a disservice against you that put you in court.
Yeah, you got some pain going on, and people in pain, you know, they're willing to do just about anything to try to deal with that pain. And their friends are saying, hey, this works, and for thousands of years this has worked. And Dr. Lester Grinspoon says, if you got something wrong with you that cannabis can be effective for, why wouldn't you try that first? Because it doesn't have any of those nasty side effects that the other treatment regimens do.
Yes.
Well, Health Canada has not yet made it possible for patients to get what they need in any kind of fashion that is decent. You get diagnosed with cancer. You go through the process. It takes 10 weeks, say, to get your paperwork through. And then 3 months to grow that first crop because you decide to do it yourself. That's 6 months out of your life that you have to try and live through whatever it is you actually needed this medicine for.
Oh, yeah, but you could have OxyContin in 45 minutes.
Oh, you could have all the OxyContin, morphine, and stuff. You can shake a stick
at
free of charge.
Yeah, okay, exactly. That statistic that you have 3,000 deaths a year from prescribed drugs, zero deaths a year from marijuana, I think that was one of the statistics that I saw out of the deal.
So if Health Canada is serious, I mean, they need to start talking to the patients. The patients are the only stakeholders that Health Canada should be listening to, and they're not. They're listening to everybody who says they're listening to patients. But I used to work with patients all the time, and they are not. They're getting unhappier because plain and simple, at this point, they are putting their licenses out there and still having to pay black market prices for their medicines
and not getting an efficient
shouldn't happen. Supply.
Okay, and then you're talking about places where it's legalized, where it's like a buck a gram.
As it should be.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, the prices that you're getting on the street are just artificially elevated, whereas it's a weed.
Yes.
Weed. A prolific weed. It's easy. Yeah. It'll grow anywhere. Throw a seed onto the ground. You got it going. Yeah, okay. And this could be the cheapest thing going to mellow people out. And they're always saying, we want a mellow population.
This would do it.
Well, come on.
They should at least let the prisoners have access to cannabis, shouldn't they? Because we're spending a lot of money on we're spending a lot of money right now so we can drug our prisoners.
Careful, you're making sense.
Most of the prisoners are on pharmaceutical medication to calm them down that we're paying for. And I mean, we should be pumping some cannabis into there.
Is that a statistic? Okay, I'm going to call you. Most of the guys in prison, or there are guys in prison, they get medication.
Pharmaceutical
medications.
You
yes,
bet they are. Yeah,
to help with rehabbing them.
Yeah, especially anybody that's the least bit hard to handle.
That's messed
they
up.
They are put on pharmaceutical.
Oppositional defiance disorder. There's a pill for that.
Yeah.
You remember the show that we did on that nonsense? We did a show on that. This is a great point. We're going to take a really quick break right now. We're going to come back in about 2 minutes. Don't forget that we've got it coming up September the 15th. We're doing our official launch at Radio Free Canada. Make sure you stay tuned for that one. And we're going to be giving away a free T-shirt during the next break for anyone who phones in and gives us a solution to world peace. We'll be right back.
Worry. We'll be gone. Joe,
right on. This is Radio Free Canada. Welcome back. A big shout out to our friends at Homeland Security. Remember, the guys at Radio Free Canada said bomb parts. Yes, indeed. We believe in saying the words bomb parts because our friends at Homeland Security like to write these things down. And our friends at CSIS, man, they're sitting there busily transcribing away. And I like to mess up with them, too, by saying obscure things like the chair is against the wall.
And bomb parts.
Darren Howard here. I'm here with Neil Magnusen. It's really good to have you in the studio. The Reverend Earl. Thank you guys very much for coming out. Okay. Now, see, before the break, we talked about the fact that everyone says dope heads, negative impact on society. Then they're saying proven science marijuana.
Yes, proven science.
Medical
marijuana.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, plenty of Canada now has a program. We've had it since 2000, technically. And the idea is that patients can petition the government to grow their own, have somebody grow their own. And over the years, things have changed because that's still not good enough for patients. They're not getting their meds in a quality, timely fashion like they're guaranteed by their rights. And so over the years, it's changed and it's changed. Now they're talking about removing the licensing altogether and making it into a private industry through mail order or some other nonsense. And again, patients are not getting medicine now. They're starting to lose faith that we'll ever get what we want. So a lot of patients have started to organize and are working towards trying to fill these gaps themselves and get in to see Health Canada at these meetings that they're having with stakeholders. Well, the only stakeholders that Health Canada should be talking to are patients. We are the ones who this program is for.
Yeah.
It's not for some company that wants to grow my medicine. I don't care about Pfizer growing medicine. They want to go grow medicine, but I'm not taking Pfizer's
medicine.
What's
the name, the medical name for when they process the marijuana? Isn't it... I can't remember. There's an actual American name for the...
Well, there's all kinds of ways of processing it.
Okay.
I mean, you can just grow it and dry it, which is curing, and then you can take and extract things from it and get very specific medicines out of it.
Okay. The medicine is actually the resin glands, right?
Exactly.
Not the plant material, but the resin glands that reside on the plant material.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Well, actually, in science is discovering that some of the other materials within the plant that are not so much a resin gland, but are basically oils and stuff from the plant, right, are also very beneficial in all kinds of ways. Right. And so it's just become this miracle plant. And again, patients who are, you know, petitioning the government for the right to have this are not getting it.
So I'm going to call you. I'm going to say evidence that it works.
Evidence that it works. Well, most people that are suffering from MS have the spasticity, and for a lot of them, and this is only anecdotal because nobody's doing proper research because, ignore the elephant, it might go away. So nobody's doing proper research, but anecdotal, which means people telling you about what's going on with them, right, has shown that these guys are having serious changes in their lifestyle because of this drug.
Right.
One very graphic example, I can't remember the name of the video, but it's on YouTube, shows a fellow who's, he can barely speak. And then he takes and he has some marijuana smoke, and his voice becomes very clear.
Okay.
I've seen shaking stops.
Yeah. All kinds of people are getting off of OxyContin and morphine because of marijuana. They can eat enough of it to control their pain.
They have done enough studies now that show that cannabis is an analgesic. It's a painkiller.
Anti-inflammatory. Yep.
Your body's chock full of cannabis receptor sites, CB1 and CB2 receptors. Your own body creates these same chemicals through your endocannabinoid endocrine system.
Your own body creates this.
Yes. It's a nutrient that our body needs to complete an actual feedback loop that it uses.
Cannabis users are actually just supplementing their own body's cannabis production or cannabinoid production from their endocannabinoid system.
Really?
Yeah.
That's the way it works.
The whole humanity.
We're deficient in the essential fatty acids, which is what our body uses to create these cannabinoids.
Okay.
And the cannabinoids within our body that our bodies create are used to balance our different systems. There's numerous different systems within the human body.
Okay.
And the endocannabinoid system and the cannabinoids that it produces, the job of those is to balance things. That's why it's an anti-inflammatory and does those
and
sorts
an
of things.
Analgesic and...
Exactly.
Okay. Okay. But you're talking about anecdotal evidence.
Yes.
There's got to be a push to study this to get something.
There is a push. In Israel is number one right now as far as doing any research on it. And I mean like studies where they're, you know, dealing with patients and the medicine itself. They actually have developed a marijuana that has no delta-9 tetrahydroxy in it whatsoever, which is the THC that everybody says gets you high. So they've developed one that has no high
And it
what's
still
the good
has.
Of that?
I don't know. Yeah, they reinvented hemp in my mind.
Know, nature had it figured out. Nature had it figured out perfectly. You're not feeling good when you've got something wrong with you, and you choose this medicine. But not only does the medicine address the inflammation or whatever else is going on, the pain, but it gives you a euphoria as well, which is exactly what you need if you're down in the dumps because your body's not working well for you.
But apparently, there are some patients who don't want all that high with it, so they've managed to develop this one, and they've actually done it through breeding and not through any Monsanto genetic modifications.
Are we just talking CBDs then?
It's CBDs and Gs.
Because they did that selective breeding back in 1942 when they wanted to continue using hemp or cannabis, but they didn't want to have the THC. So during 1942 to 1944,
that's
the U.S.
what they
government,
based it on.
They selectively bred the THC out of a couple of strains, and that's what we use for hemp today as cousins of those strains.
It could be.
Yeah, but it's high in CBD.
Yeah,
you know, and
that's
and
what they're
the
going
CBD
for. CBDs
is also, you know, a very valid medicine for sure.
Yeah.
The one statement that I heard out of this is that when you start getting cannabis on a regular basis, the receptors increase within certain cell structures.
Yeah, I haven't heard that.
Well, basically, you're re-enriching your system with these things that you actually need, right?
Mm-hmm.
And as anecdotal evidence, again, I have a personal friend who. Over time, their eyes are getting worse, right? And they, because of their need for marijuana, they've began eating it and this and that, and they've noticed an improvement in their eyes.
Mm-hmm.
That now they don't need the glasses to read as much because something's changed in their eyes. And the only thing that's changed in their diet is the marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
And even though they're using it for other benefits, this eye benefit is actually one of the things that you can Google and find out. It's good for quite a few different maladies of the eye.
Mm-hmm.
From what we know, it's correcting the pressure in her eye that causes the loss of sight that she was suffering.
There is an empirical statement that you know could be valid and used in these processes, and that's in Genesis 1:1 in the first page of the Bible.
Okay.
It talks about how God created these seed-bearing herbs, how he looked upon them and saw that they were all very good, said that they were for everyone, and that the leaves were for the healing of the nations.
Yes, the leaves are for the healing of the nations is what he
so,
said.
So, you know, we could just go on that particular study that was done early on by the Creator.
and he
no,
meant
you're
all.
You're going to get it. Like, okay, well, the religion.
Homeland
like,
Security's coming after me again. We're talking God now.
No, it's okay.
Okay, there's the elephant in the room. God is the big marijuana dealer. He's the manufacturer of cannabis. And
that's the guy I say to talk to. As far as I'm concerned, they really want to arrest somebody. I'm a minister. I'd be okay with them questioning my God.
No, I mean, he made a lot of he made a lot of plants. I mean, you know, he makes
seed-bearing plants too.
Couple mistakes, you know. I mean,
God.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just because he made people does not mean he makes that many mistakes.
We shouldn't believe man when man says that God made mistakes. We should just trust God.
Well, I wouldn't. Yes, I would rather trust God with that
one.
When it comes to the seed-bearing plants, I'm with God.
You know, I hit that one right on the head when we were talking about conservative Christians in action. Okay, would Jesus be allowed in the church? Well, no, because he's not Christ-like. You know, he doesn't wear a suit and tie. He doesn't have cream cop hair.
His hair is too long.
You know, he doesn't have a good job. He's not driving a nice car.
Probably barefoot.
The standards have changed somewhat.
Like taxes.
Okay. Yeah. And they've attached this morality thing to it. Okay. Where it's immoral to smoke dope. Okay. But now we've got. Okay. So let's get back to just real quick for the medical things. The cancer thing.
Yes. Cancer is very harsh on people. And I for one, have been diagnosed with it. And I'm pretty sure that the way I'm feeling, how good I'm feeling with having lung cancer. The amassed 10 centimeters plus is from juicing green marijuana and using that as part of my diet to keep my system up so that I was able to handle the radiation that I ended up getting.
Okay.
And I still ended up very, very sick and in the hospital and had to technically, you know, be refed and stuff and to get my strength back after being irradiated because this stuff beats the crap out of you, right?
Sometimes
they
cure.
The marijuana is I'm thinking helping a lot with keeping my body from destroying itself really badly with the radiation so that I can recover through this easier because otherwise, without the marijuana, I would have probably fallen apart already. The mass would have just grown. There would have been nothing to stop it. Marijuana is just that's what I'm using mostly.
And you know,
on top with like a green diet, organic diet of proper fruits and vegetables and lots of greens and trying to keep my pH up and all. Like there's, if it wasn't for marijuana, I wouldn't even have the patience to do all this studying that goes with it either.
If nothing else, and I mean, I know that cannabis has medicinal properties for sure, but if it didn't, it certainly has placebo qualities. A lot of people believe in it,
yes.
and that has great power as well.
We know that for a fact, the placebo thing. Okay. Yeah. Now, I always say this too. I tell people, you're stressed out. Okay, relax.
Yeah,
it helps you relax. It's better than taking some heavy-duty chemicals that have been processed or not natural. This is a natural thing that has a natural effect.
And it's a no-brainer that it's a stress reliever, that's for sure. Just chill, man. Just, you know, go smoke a joint and chill out.
Well, you know that statement, if I could get the world to smoke a joint, we'd have world peace for 2 hours.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. You know, but that's a little bit more realistic. Okay,
well,
that's on your couch reality.
And stress is a big-time problem in our society. It's a killer amongst other debilitating things that it results in for
Absolutely.
People.
Absolutely. Okay, and we've got enough pressures on us already.
Yeah.
You've got the rat race out there. You've got economies that are crumbling. We have people that require a little bit of peace and sanity about all of this.
After 2001, 9/11... Mm-hmm. Everybody should have been allowed to smoke a joint if they wanted to.
Yeah. you know what? I can't agree with you anymore. Like, I can't agree with you enough on that.
At that point, they had to legalize that stuff and say, okay, population, just you can all smoke a joint now. Wow, that was really horrible, wasn't it?
Yeah. And I think that probably, you know, Jean Charest over in Quebec wish that everybody in Quebec was a little more mellow.
Yeah.
They might have accepted Bill 78, right?
Oh, yeah.
We do say this from time to time here. Hey, John, how's Bill 78 working out for you? This is what people are in action. But let's talk about that for a second, okay? Just so you know, and for those people who are paying attention to the network world, this is the long format that we're going to follow right now. We are going to take the regular network break coming up here in 5 minutes, and we're going to come back and cover a couple things, okay? So we're going to keep you for overtime.
All right.
But let's talk about your interaction. What responses are we getting? Okay. Now, you started this out in 2006.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's 7 years or 6 years now, right?
I met a fair amount of mayors in 2006, 2007, and 2008.
Okay.
And the response was considerably different than it has been this year in almost every municipality.
Okay, talk about it. What were the first responses like?
They didn't want to talk about it. You know, when I would walk in there and say, I'm on a Cross Canada awareness tour and we want to talk about the harms being caused by drug prohibition.
Yeah.
Wow, they just didn't want me in the room. They didn't want to talk about it, you know. And now it's just so turned around. I mean, the people at city halls are just incredible. They're more than enthusiastic. Most of them, when I come in there and say, here's what I'm here for. I want to talk about the harm being caused in our society by prohibition.
Uh-huh.
They know all about it. Many of them are already just the choir members that I'm preaching to.
Okay.
They're happy that I'm there. They're thrilled to take my hand out and pass it on to the mayor if the mayor's not there or whatever it is. At some of the police stations, I'm getting a lot more reluctancy, you know, to listen to what I'm having to say. But still, at some of the other ones, I'm getting, you know, reception people and police people who are very interested in what I'm having to say, do want to have the conversation. And I think they're somewhat relieved. You know, what I'm actually doing is I'm taking these documents to every police station that I can find from Victoria to Nova Scotia and Sydney, Nova Scotia, and I'm filing them as a actual formal complaint.
Okay, let's hit on that for a second. You're taking in a legal document.
I'm taking
into
a document,
cop shop.
I'm taking in a supporting document to my complaint.
Okay.
My complaint is that based on the supporting document that I'm bringing and other evidence that I have found through my own research, I don't walk in there willy-nilly. I'm not like just saying, oh, well, maybe this is the case and I want to go. No. I've done a lot of looking into this. I know this is the case, and now these other experts are saying so too. The Attorney General say in their statement that they released, the case against prohibition is airtight. These are people who choose their words very, very carefully.
Yes.
So, you know, it is airtight. And so I'm in there lodging a formal complaint and of a criminal conspiracy at the highest level of our federal government, of an abuse of power, of contempt for the populace, and for a criminal misuse of our public funds. Mm-hmm. And I'm backing that up with the documents that I'm submitting there.
And then what we're going to do is we're going to take a quick break because our timing is immaculate right now.
Perfect.
I can't believe how well this is timing out because we've got to get into the specifics of what's on the form. Okay, so we're going to be right back, okay? I am Darren Howard.
Reverend Earl here.
Yes.
And Neil Magnuson from the Freedom Tour.
And we're going to take a really quick break right here because we kind of have to pay some bills. So thank you very much for joining us. Back again, law enforcement against prohibition and Freedom Tour right here. Freedomtour.ca, is that right?
That's it. Leap.cc.
All right. We're back again with more Revolution in the Consciousness. 2-minute break right now, and we'll be back with Neil Magnuson, Radio Free Canada. Good to have you along. Radio Free Canada, welcome back to the Revolution Hour number 2 of the fastest 2 hours in talk radio. Remember that everything that you hear here is protected under Section 2 of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Stephen Harper, you have to take that away from me, kicking and screaming. You do not get your way because we have freedom of speech and we're exercising it. And all media produced and distributed here is protected under international fair usage copyright law. So YouTube, you just can't take us down. We're Radio Free Canada. This is Red Pill Radio. How well it's working out today. Our timing just seems to be perfect for some reason, but it's one of those important subject days. Okay, we've got a really important show here, and we're talking about law enforcement against prohibition. We'd like to do a big shout out to WTPN in New York. Hi, Roger, how are you doing? It's good to be talking directly into your ear. Make sure you get back to work and work more hours during the day. Lynn is going to have my butt for saying that. He works way too hard. The guys who are spreading the word in the Liberty Hour right over there at WTPN are doing an excellent job. Make sure that you tune in and talk about Tools for Justice. It's a very interesting show that they've coming up, and they've got a show coming up on Agenda 21. We're going to be covering that one. It, pretty interesting stuff. Kind of messed up.
I've been reading on that Agenda 21 a few years now. It's
You know, it's for real, okay?
Wow.
You know, face palm, okay, you know, head palm. On the nonsense that's coming out of there, you mentioned earlier, Neil, you, okay, just so you know, this is Darren Howard, this is the Reverend Earl here, Neil Magnusen, and if you don't tune in the last hour, you're not going to catch up, so give up, go back to the last hour and start listening from the beginning. Neil, you mentioned the UN did a study.
They did. They did worldwide conferences. Looking at the unintended consequences of prohibition and attempted prohibition.
Okay.
They brought in experts around the world to discuss these things, and they found that the unintended consequences are vast and many. It is costing a huge amount of money, and it's just causing nothing but problems for our society. The disrespect for police is huge.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, for a policeman to not be respected within his jurisdiction puts his life at risk.
Yes.
You know?
And which puts the whole community at risk, really.
It really does.
Yeah.
And when kids learn that they can't respect the laws, then that causes all kinds of mayhem in our society. It's just there's a whole bunch of unintended consequences. Like, it increases the demand. I mean, it would be nice, you know, maybe if a government knew better than us and there was some substance that nobody could use successfully with any benefit, and they could say, don't use that, and then nobody would use that, and then maybe that would be all right. But I don't even think that would be all right, because we can't trust these people in our society to make those decisions. They certainly don't know better than all of the populace. They don't even have our best interests in mind.
But that's what they think. That's what they're saying, is we know better, therefore we put more rules in, and society stays in one piece.
And it's just a coincidence, I guess, that it happens to satisfy the interests of the pharmaceutical lobbyists and the fuel lobbyists and all these other lobbyists. You know, I love what David Malmo Levine says, and if you're in Vancouver, go check out his museum. It's awesome. It's in the 300 block of Hastings there.
Kay.
But David, he says, you know, I'm a conspiracy theorist, and I'm proud of that. Because I've had a good look at the issues. And if you're not a conspiracy theorist, well, then you have to be a coincidence theorist. And he'd just rather be a conspiracy theorist than a coincidence theorist, because you've got to be nuts to think that all this stuff is just coincidence.
Yeah. You mentioned that before, okay? You said criminal conspiracy. Now, conspiracy has that big word. It's big stigma.
We live in a supposedly free country. We don't have dictators, tyrants, kings, queens, or anyone like that that's in power over us. We have public servants. And the public servant's job is to protect the interests of the populace. So if they're being lobbied behind closed doors by groups with huge amounts of leverage, and then just coincidentally the laws happen to line up that protect their interests, well, that smells like a rat to me.
Okay.
And if there's just the slightest hint of some sort of a scandal like that in a free country with public servants, well, you would think that our police would be all over that, but they're not. It really looks like the RCMP are there to protect whatever shenanigans the federal government or the ruling party wants to get involved with, and just try to put to bed any scandals that would seem to arise, rather than making sure that anything that even looks like it might be a scandal gets properly snuffed out and looked at.
But
so that's hinting of a conspiracy. But when 10 years ago our Senate said that the prohibition policies are costing our society far more than the scourge of drug abuse ever could, and 10 years later, they're still involved in those same policies, and now the experts from across the board, from Coastal Health in Vancouver, to the AGs, the Attorney Generals, to LEAP, the law enforcement people, to the mayors, who are actually right there at the grassroots in the communities that are seeing the harm that's being done, when they're all writing open letters and getting on board and joining a group called Stop the Violence and other things like that, then, you know, this has got to be looked at. There needs to be at least a public inquiry into this, because if it isn't a criminal conspiracy at the high level of our federal government, well, man, I'll tell you could sure fool me, because it looks exactly like that's what's going on here.
But what we see right now is the fact that regardless of what government laws are broken, they just continue in power. They ignore the rule of law altogether in the court system.
Their only accountability because of this is the way they have designed the system once they've gotten into power, although it's not really power. They're holding a public trust. But once they get there, over the course of time, they have produced legislation that prevents them from being accountable. The only accountability we have with our public servants is to vote them out next time if we don't like them, and we can all get together and do that. And there's some other group that we like better. But, you know, what kind of a system is this? I mean, the other group is just another group of bandits. I mean, you got really nobody to vote for. The only other party that might not be completely co-opted by corporate forces will be if they ever get into power or anywhere close to it. This is our system here. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they've taken away their own accountability, and that's wrong to begin with. If we had a system where they were limited to begin with, where they could not enforce laws on any citizen unless there was significant evidence that there was some demonstrable damage being done, no enforcement of laws unless that's the case. If they were accountable themselves, like we were supposed to be accountable back in the days when we had the principles of fundamental justice, you know, where you have the scales of justice, where when they put a damage or amount of damage that you did, it's got a dollar value to it, a weight to it,
right,
and then a penalty somewhere that balances the scale. Well, when with a stroke of a pen, you can enact legislation that protects some corporate group and makes criminals out of a whole bunch of your citizens when it's not even a crime, like the cannabis laws is what I'm talking about, obviously, yeah. 2 million Canadians with criminal records. They didn't intend to harm anybody. There was no victim in their wake. They simply had possession of something they thought was going to help make them feel better. Mm-hmm. So with all of those people with criminal records now and all this damage being done here through the prohibition laws, mm-hmm. the fact that they haven't been repealed a long time ago really, really stinks. I mean,
yeah.
Something's real. You know, whose interests are being served? Well, those people that want to sell you pharmaceuticals, for example. Those people that would rather have you smoking tobacco than cannabis, for another example. And whoever it is that's profiting on alcohol are probably beneficiaries of these pot prohibition laws.
Yeah.
Well, that just happens to be the same government that's using your tax dollars to keep you from using that marijuana.
You know, you got cold beer.
Wow.
You got cold beer and wine stores.
You got a beer and whiskey festival coming on somewhere in the Okanagan. I heard about that on the radio. A big beer and whiskey festival.
Okay, they can't celebrate alcohol fast enough. They can't open up another liquor store fast enough. Here in town, we've seen four times as many as 20 years ago when I started in college 25 years ago.
I was at Petro-Canada. They had a huge wall full of alcohol behind the counter there.
I know. Okay, Now this is getting a little bit crazy, but we're just adding another product. We're just saying, put another cabinet and just put it behind
exactly.
there.
If they can sell alcohol, they can't sell BC Bud. Superstore well,
Alberta.
Alcohol?
Superstore Alberta has a big alcohol outlets now, too. I mean,
just
everywhere.
Like the States, okay? You know, you go down the States, you go to 7-Eleven to buy your beer.
Yeah, man.
And that's messed up.
Alcohol's big.
Okay?
Alcohol's huge.
But we do have the last time that they talked about legalizing it was when the Tories were in power, 2004, I believe. And or not the Tories, the Liberals.
Yeah.
Liberals were in power. And then we had the Secretary of State from the States come up and say, no.
Yeah.
If you do that, we're going to have issues. We don't even want to see you raising the subject.
Yeah,
yes.
No, they
it would affect
us.
Free trade and everything, we were told, yes.
Yeah, okay. So, I mean, are we seeing a lot of pressure?
Isn't that a sovereignty issue?
In all reality,
you know?
Okay.
It's like, you know, we seem to let these things just, you know, we mention them and it's like it's no big deal. These are huge deals. Some other country is threatening us about what we do with our citizens here.
At some point,
it was definitely a big discussion that was out there. But the reality is, as Neil just said, is that that's another country telling Canada what to do.
You know, I didn't
hire anybody or vote for anybody that's going to allow any other country to tell Canada what to do.
But well, now we got cops coming up from the States. They're allowed to come in here and operate.
Yes. And
FBI is allowed to come up here.
Five different law enforcement agencies from the United States has jurisdiction
are working
in Canada now.
And they get Homeland Security can come into Canada.
Yeah.
Okay.
And access to our records as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So sovereignty. Well, can you say that we've got it?
Can
if
you
we're
say 51st state of America?
We are in negotiations, whether people want to believe it or not. Here's another one of those conspiracy theories. We are in negotiations with Mexico and America, period, to become one nation with one border. Period.
And one set of
and
prohibition
one set
laws.
Of rules and one healthcare system and one prison system. We are being molded into a 51st state, a new part of America, a new America, basically.
Yeah.
And Canadians don't realize this is really happening. And
well, they already have,
we have
the Amero.
We
know that they have the Amero. Okay, that's a real currency.
We need our sovereignty. Sure, the UN says nobody needs sovereignty. We should all be sovereign to each other and the globe. Great, but not on this watch.
Not on my watch, it ain't going to
happen. Because this watch, no, this is not the right time for that.
But here's a scenario for you that everybody's pointing at. We're starting to get major memes on this one. The American economy falls, which is what's occurring right now. They go totally bankrupt. The UN incorporates the American military as NATO. UN, they take over that function. The International Monetary Fund then funds it, okay, so that they're the ones paying the paycheck, and then they take over that whole industry. And now the American dollar is worth nothing compared to the Canadian, and we have to trade in the Amero in order to trade with the States.
It's a very feasible possibility, unfortunately.
That is what is being spouted as the agenda. And over time, I've seen many different proofs of this on American government sites and Canadian government sites. And you just, the Canadian public and the American public are still scratching their head going, I'm not sure if this is really happening, but we're supposed to be becoming one country. I don't want to be one country. I don't know about Americans or Mexicans. I'm sure they feel the same way.
They're feeling the attack down there. They know that their sovereignty is under attack, but their constitution just went out the door this year. You got the NDAA down there. You got Homeland Security. They got signed in again. You've got Afghanistan and Iraq where they're still staying
Under the same impression as us. They believe that these guys have been working for us. And so in the last 40 years, well, they've been changing all of these rules a little at a time here and there. We've been thinking they're working for us, and we give up all our responsibility about knowing what they were doing. So we just let it happen over and over again.
Guess what? Guess what, folks? They're not working for you.
Not anymore. No, they changed the rules.
You're paying them. They're now taking your money to do what they do, but they're not doing what you want.
That's a great point. We're going to make a quick break right now. We're going to come back in about 2 minutes, and we're going to go over a piece of paper that the RCMP sees on their doorstep from time to time. Free Canada, reminding the New World Order that everything is cracking around your plans. You are never going to get us under control. Canada is going to be sovereign for the rest of history. Yeah. I just like to poke the bear a little bit. You know what I mean? Because I get fed up with that, we're going to be another state of the states things.
Yeah.
I have no time for that whatsoever. I'm Canadian. I'm proud of it, and I like it.
That's right.
Yeah, keep it that way. Okay, we are talking to Neil Magnusen here. And Neil, you do an amazing thing. You do a scary thing. You walk into a cop shop with a piece of paper.
Well, with a pack of papers, actually.
Okay, it's a pack of papers.
It's a six-page document, double-sided paper. And on the cover of it says, "We support the legions of brave men and women who have laid their lives on the line to fight for the freedom of the generations to come." And that's us.
Right.
It has what is in Canada rendered by a judge and considered to be the legal definition of freedom.
Yeah.
That freedom is the right to do or not do whatever you want to do or don't want to do without any interference, coercion, or prohibition unless you unreasonably interfere with someone else. And lest we forget that they died for our freedom. So that's the cover of the document.
That cover, that first statement here, you're talking to guys, cops. They've signed up. They're going to enforce law. Okay. Does that hit them?
You would hope so. You would hope so.
Okay.
I mean, maybe they think I've just co-opted those terms and those words and put them on my piece of paper, and I'm just some pothead that wants to get pot legal, so I don't get arrested. Maybe not. But I don't think so. You know, I cut my hair after the first tour, so I've looked rather respectable ever since then.
Oh, you were long hair when you started out.
All my life I had long hair, okay. But after the first tour, I could tell that there was something else in the room with us that was causing me some problems, and I had to cut that off.
So, gotcha.
You know, I went to the short hair, and I dress well whenever I go in there. I have dress shoes and dress pants, and... You know, I wear a leap pin from the law enforcement against prohibition.
Yeah.
And, you know, I represent those people, or at least I support those people. I can't represent them other than as a civilian member, which I am. But I am taken very seriously now by the police when I walk in there. I think they understand that I'm not just some youngster that, you know.
You're a civilian member of the...
I'm a civilian member of LEAP, and I'm a very concerned citizen, and I'm a patriot of this country. I love this country very much, and I love what this country is supposed to stand for, which is tolerance and understanding and politeness and all of those good things that Canadians are supposed to be known for. And I'm very upset with our now foreign policies and our domestic policies, especially with respect to drug prohibition, and what that's done to our communities and gangs all over the place, from Montreal to Vancouver and Winnipeg and all these other places that are just really beaten down by the scourge of all of these gangs and all of the unintended consequences of drug prohibition. Mm-hmm. And our federal government just keeps soldiering right on with the same policies because they're serving the interests of those guys that have lobbied them, and there's big bucks being spent by huge corporate outfits to try to maintain this prohibition of cannabis.
It comes down to who a politician listens to, who a judge takes his cues from, and how they behave. It's not like a cut and dried thing.
A public servant's job is to try to decide how to spend public money.
Right.
You know, which contracts to go with. They're lobbied by these people who want them to take their contracts. That should all be transparent. It should really be there for all of us to see what's happening, not behind closed doors. And we'd have a different type of public servant, I think, if we had them limited in their ability to enforce laws when there's no demonstrable harm being done. If we had them accountable so that if they did serve corporate interests at our expense, they were really, really held to task for that. It's a heinous crime, really, the amount of people that get damaged with that. And if they were transparent in their actions so that they weren't able to go on cruises, go to the golf course, close the doors, have a meeting, and then make decisions, that really what we need to have is MP watch. And I think we'd all be willing to pay for that. We're paying for a lot of, you know, soldiers to go to Afghanistan and other things like that. I think we'd all be happy to pay for two or three people with a camera crew as a camera crew to follow our MPs around from the time they leave their home until they get home at night.
When we see, you know, we see Iceland. Iceland is crowdsourcing. They're crowdsourcing their laws.
Yeah.
Okay. So they're saying, we're going to write a brand new constitution. We want our citizens to write it.
I mean, we have to be careful with that, too,
the ultimate responsibility is, as a citizen, to make sure that if we're going to hire people to do these jobs, we have to make sure that that job is very, very clearly defined for them, apparently.
Yeah. and if we're going to be having citizens decide on laws, we need to understand that democracy doesn't mean that the 51% get to overrule the rights of the 49%.
Which is the way it is.
It's the way it is. Mob rule. Yeah,
right.
and that's not okay. Democracy. You know, just because you get 51% doesn't mean 49% lose their rights, you know. 99% can't take away the rights of one person because everyone has a natural right to not be bullied in their life.
Exactly.
To do whatever they want to do or not do what they don't want to do without anybody using their force against them when they're vulnerable to make them do stuff they don't want to do.
Okay, so you're familiar with Plato's Republic. Somewhat.
To some degree.
Okay, and what his statement is, the individual citizen is sovereign.
Yeah, yes. I believe in
that. And he's part of a collective. Yeah, you can believe in that? You can see that?
And I'm okay with the collective, too.
Yes.
Okay.
You know, but everybody gets their individual rights protected within that collective.
Yeah, and then, you know, if you want to go to war, this is one of the things Rome was famous for. You had to convince people to join the army.
Yeah, no, I think if they're deciding to go to war, that's when we need to have mandatory cannabis consumption.
Yes, mandatory. It's like we're looking for overdose rates right now. Anybody want to try?
There will be no war without a bong.
No war without a bong.
Matter of fact,
because there would be no war with a bong. You see, that's the paradox right there.
Right,
we will have no war without a bong, and we will have no war with a bong.
We will double fist our way.
There will be no war.
Yes. Double fisting till there's no war.
That's right.
War is starting to become one of those antique concepts out of the whole thing.
Well,
but the war on drugs, Stephen Harper gets nailed right up to the wall. He says, where was it? What was it? May? I think it was. He was asked. He said, look, the war on drugs is a failure. And yes, his response was, but we're going to keep going.
Yeah, yes. Pretty much. Pretty
okay.
much.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're not going to stop it. It is a failure. He at least could admit that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's not a failure for those corporations that are reaping the benefits of it.
Which yes, is I mean, the RCMP, and the Law yeah. Society.
The drug gangs, the corporate gangs, and the police gangs.
The okay. guys who aren't losing money and the guys who are making money.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so now, what do I do? What do I do to start fixing this problem? You've gone across, you're talking to RCMP officers. What do you think we should be doing?
I don't know. You know, everybody's got their own little unique way of seeing things and their own special set of skills to bring to whatever issue we have here. People need to think about it and recognize this is really wrong, it's really important, and I need to play a role, and then try to find what that role is. I mean, for me, I've decided that I'm a good spokesperson for this. I can really see these issues clearly, and I can articulate that, so I think I'm the right guy, or at least I've appointed myself the guy to go to the police stations and try to have that conversation and try to file this as a formal complaint.
You hit that right on the money, and that's one of the hard questions. What gives you the credibility to do what you're doing?
Well, you know, I'm self-appointed,
yeah.
But I'm not without a lot of feedback from a large community of people who know me and support me in what I do.
Yeah.
And I take feedback as I go through every day on the road, meeting new people, explaining what I'm doing. And I've got so many people telling me, man, I love what you're doing. Please keep yeah. on doing what yeah. you're doing. And let's figure out how to get this thing done right.
You see,
I'd like to see other people go to police stations and do what I'm doing, too. You know, take your own supporting doc.
That's kind of scary, man.
But, you know, why? You know, what are they going to do? Are they really going to arrest you because you walk in there with some supporting documents and say, I'm really concerned about what's going on with my government?
I think the vast majority of people are very intimidated by the RCMP.
I understand. I have some trepidation myself, of course. It's a natural thing because they have guns. And, uh-huh. and they know how to intimidate, uh-huh. and they're trained to, you know, look at you a certain way, and stand a certain way, and, uh-huh.
trained to
yeah,
psychologically
and dismiss your concerns yes. a certain way. They're very good at dismissing yeah. your concerns a certain way too. But for me, it was practice, you know, and I just kept doing it and kept really getting better at it, and really feeling more and more concerned or comfortable about it. I was using cannabis for my own personal needs the first three tours, and I did not have an exemption from the government. Mm-hmm. And I was always concerned when I walked in there that, you know, they were going to search my vehicle or search my person or something, and that was going to be enough to get me in handcuffs.
Yep.
Although, you know, for me, my family has grown. I don't have, you know, any concerns about my own, you know, future that way. And if I have to go to jail or if I'm going to be persecuted for my cannabis advocacy, well, I'll wear that like a badge and I'll take that as a compliment that, you know, that I'm making a difference somehow. So that's for me. You know, I mean, people that have families and concerns about their future, they have to be careful about that, of course. And I wouldn't want anybody being reckless in their own life and ruining their life and trying to solve these issues. We have to be smart about it. But, you know, it starts by just talking to your neighbors. It starts by educating yourself, making sure you really understand the issues,
mm-hmm.
and then talking about it with your neighbors and your family and your friends. Maybe calling open line shows, maybe starting to write letters,
mm-hmm.
Getting involved with other people who are doing things that you appreciate what they're doing and support them in that. You know, there's just a myriad of different things that people can get involved with to try to make a difference.
We tried to do that here at the local radio station. We get shut out all the time. They will not hear it, okay? They're pro-conservative, just hardline conservatives within the local media here. So we have everyone out there saying, we have the most bizarre stories from senior citizens locally, the main consumers of public media, that marijuana is a psychedelic.
Yeah.
It's a gateway drug that you'll go to crack.
Yeah.
You know, smoke a joint, you're smoking crack next week, you're going to be sold and slave, you know, sex labor.
Cannabis is a gateway drug to hard drugs because of its prohibition. And
okay.
that's the reason.
Because, I'm going to give you a minute to explain that. Go ahead.
Well, you know, we've got police that are going into classrooms and telling the kids there that there's this group of illegal drugs.
Right.
And they're all bad and they're all the same. And that's just not the truth at all.
Right.
And the kids, by the time they're 14, 15, you know, some of their friends are now using cannabis and they decide to give it a try. And wow, you know, that was okay.
Nobody died.
And wow, if that was fun. then these other drugs, they must be fun too. So, you know, they think that there's no respect for the what the police said to them in the classroom, and that if marijuana doesn't seem to be such a bad thing, then maybe crack isn't such a bad thing either, and maybe these other things, they're worth trying too. So there's that aspect. There's another aspect as well.
Okay.
And that is that a person, when they're using cannabis illegally and they're purchasing it from the underground market, that underground salesperson is just as happy to bump them up into some other type of powder that's more addictive, that's easier to consume, easier to trade in.
Yeah.
So, you know, that there's another example of why it's a gateway drug onto hard drugs.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and the other, and there's a third one.
Oh,
and
okay.
That is that when a young person uses cannabis, they're now a criminal. And they're in that realm of criminals.
Right.
So to use the other drugs and be a criminal with that, it's no, you haven't done anything new. You're not more of a criminal because you use cocaine than you were yesterday when you used marijuana. So now they're in that realm of criminals, and now they have no respect for the law, and now they're going to do all of these different things.
That's awesome point. That's a great point. Go ahead.
Well, see, I agree a lot with what you're saying on that, but the one thing that I think we always end up missing is the actual human potential in this particular idea. Because just like guns don't kill people, okay?
Right.
People kill people. So the guns that we're talking about are these drugs, and they were brought in front of the children by an adult, and the adult tried to tell the child stuff about the drugs. But if that adult had not brought those drugs in front of the child,
they wouldn't even know.
Those children wouldn't know.
Yeah.
There might be two children in that classroom who somewhere in their life will come into contact with some of those drugs, but they instead take it to them and open the gateway.
Them. Yeah.
And say, this is the gateway. Watch out for it. Don't fall into the gateway.
Well, but you've hit on something else, Earl. And that is that when you tell a young person that something is dangerous,
they gotta check it out. They might as
they
well.
Live for danger.
It's like putting parental advisory on the thing.
Wow, let's watch that.
Every teenager. Oh, yeah, I want to watch that.
So, oh, no, the teenagers aren't watching anything that doesn't have the parental advisory on it. That's a waste of their time.
That's what they're looking for.
That's how they tell them what it is that they want to go see.
Where's the good stuff? Parental advisory.
Danger? Yeah, man, I live for danger. I'm not. Nothing can hurt me. And, I mean, it's that mentality that's out there as well. So there's four good reasons that you should not try to prohibit something like cannabis, because it turns it into a gateway drug.
Yes.
You're
and makes you part of that gate.
But yeah, I got to tell you something else, too. We touched on this gateway to hard drugs, you know.
Yeah.
Many, many people will try those hard drugs in their adolescence and reject them along the way. The ones that stay involved with them primarily are the 1%, 1.1% of our population that's been static at that number for over 100 years.
Yeah.
These are the abused children of our society. They suffer what the healthcare professionals call conjunctive traumas. Starts with early sexual child abuse with many of them. It goes to the loss of a parent, a horrible marriage breakup, other things, just, you know, a myriad of different things that can happen to people. And the ones that end up on the hard substances that we call the addicts, they're the ones that are suffering from several of those types of traumatic things.
Yes, and need all that help that our healthcare system can get. Through
another day. If they weren't down on the downtown east side stuck in poverty, and many of them aren't, many of them do work and function, yet they don't function well. They don't function well in the workplace. They don't function well in relationships. So spiraling down into poverty is a common thing for the abused children that have grown into adults in our society. They end up on the downtown east side where they're preyed upon by the street dealers, because that's where all the services are, and that's where other people with like experiences are that they can relate to. But then the prohibitionists say, that's what drugs will do to you. You know, that's what will happen if you start smoking marijuana. You're going to end up down there. And that is just not the truth for most
people.
No,
that's not the truth. This is, you're always attaching all evils to this one thing. Okay,
Larry Campbell, he likes to say, and I love this when Larry Campbell says this one. He says, if marijuana was a gateway onto the harder substances, we'd have a lot more Canadians on hard substances.
A lot more. We talk about, and we just got a couple minutes left here, okay? We're just winding things up right now with Neil Magnusen and the Reverend Earl. But we do talk about the fact that addictions, you have an addictive personality, okay? We've got people who are addicted to fast food. We got people who are addicted to shopping. We don't see big interventions on that, even though obesity is going to be our number one health issue in 10 years. We know that's the statistic, okay?
There should be regulations on packaging for things that have white refined sugar in them. They shouldn't be able to be made all so nice and pretty. Advertising restrictions would be a good idea for that stuff, because they sure make it look attractive to you, you know? And really, there's big encouragement for those corporations to be able to prey on people. We're all addicted to sugars,
yeah,
because that's the fuel that we use. They've learned that they can refine out all the good stuff and keep only,
yeah,
the taste. And you know, that's what you say. Obesity is now outstripped starvation as a killer in this, in,
yeah,
this world,
yeah,
of ours.
And it's getting to the point with our food anyway that, you know, basically we're putting so much into it that it's filler. That when we do eat the food, there's very little of it that of the processed foods we have in the world, yeah, today that is actually nutritious or even recognizable to our body as food.
Yeah.
So we're actually handing out starvation rations.
Plant cells are not much involved in fast food.
Yeah.
You know, and they're putting sugar in everything from peanut butter to potato chips.
Yes.
Yes. You know? Okay.
The cellulose tastes better while it's empty calories.
And they get
calories.
You addicted early. I mean, actually, it starts, yeah, in the mother's stomach. I mean, and
yes,
mother's milk ferments into,
yes,
into alcohol-type sugars as well. Alcohol is sugar crack. At 1 year's age, or 1 year birthday, you get cake and ice cream, and we all got that picture going on.
Yep,
yeah.
And then there's Easter and Christmas and all these other holidays.
Oh,
they've,
yeah,
all been taken over by big sugar.
Yeah.
And Halloween is the big one, right?
I mean, oh, yeah.
That's where you get together with a group of your friends and you form a gang and you all dress up in really scary clothes and you go door to door saying, give me my
give
sugar
my
fix
sugar.
Or I'm going to mess your house up or a trick or treat or something like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know, we're really conditioning the populace to be right involved with this whole sugar addiction thing. And it's part of everything. And they're preying on us. That's what's happening, is these people that want to suck your money out of you, want you to consume their stuff, they love that you're addicted to sugar, and they love that they can put that into everything.
But the human, yep, the human condition is, you know, part of our survival mechanism within our head. If you're doing something, keep doing it. It is something that's contributing to your survival, okay? Yeah. So they get you addicted to shopping. They get you addicted to 3 hours of TV.
Yeah.
Okay, if you live a consumer lifestyle, you are somehow successful.
Yeah.
That's the message that we're getting. Yeah. And then, you know, now here in the conservative wonderland that we live in, if you wear a suit and tie and drive a Humvee, you are successful.
Right.
How does that make a successful human? We don't have natural endorphin processes in society other than cause and reward.
Yeah, we've been very far removed from our natural way of being, that's for,
yes,
sure.
Yes. Okay.
That's for sure.
You know what? We've done it, and we're overtime. So we love everybody who's in the network world right now. And unfortunately, we did get cut off by a couple guys out there. So because they had to bail because of the long format that we're doing in. So, but whatever.
It's all right.
It is. You
we'll
know what?
The first time, we'll be last.
We're not corporate radio, okay? We don't fit inside the box. And we're kind of proud when these things happen because they're not allowed to do this in the big world.
Oh, bummer. Oops. We did.
We're allowed to play vinyl. We're allowed to say all kinds of things because this is freedom of speech and action. Neil Magnusen, I really appreciate the work that you're doing. And on behalf of everyone at Radio Free Canada and all of our friends, because we do not have fans, we just have friends.
Yeah, nice.
And we're saying that we really appreciate the work you're doing. Okay.
Thank you very much, and thank you for allowing me the opportunity to express myself on your show.
Hey, no, we're there for you, okay?
Cool, man.
And you got to stay in touch and keep us in. It is freedomtour.ca.
Freedomtour.ca, leap.cc. And
okay.
If you're on Facebook, it's Facebook event Freedom Tour 2012. Yes.
Okay. So we're going to put up those links on
can
Radio
I do one
Free
more
Canada?
Thing? We can take another
Go.
Moment.
Go.
I'd like to thank cannabisculture.com. I'd like to thank the VancouverSeedBank.com. I'd like to thank the PainManagementSociety.org. All of those people who have kicked in and helped me in so many ways to make this tour happen. And all those people who continue to wave and honk and support me as I go.
Right on. Okay, and we're going to get you back again as soon as you get back into town here. So, Earl, any last?
Well, as I said, I'm an activist here, and I've always been here for the patients first. And now that I've, for whatever reason, I'm actually a patient myself now, and that has just put the impetus even further into let's get this done now. We need leadership, and I'm going to be constantly pushing our local leaders and anybody who has a position of authority within the health community to start really dialoguing with patients about what it is that we do have and don't have when it comes to this program and how we can get there, because we have answers. We just need to be at the table for a change as the actual stakeholders.
Right on.
ahead. Come on out on Saturday to Kelowna to Kerry Park and join us as we go and protest these immoral laws and make a difference.
Yes.
You know it. All right. Well, thanks a lot for coming out, and it's very cool to bring you Radio Free Canada here. We remind you that the revolution is occurring. Real people are winning, and we are there for you for sure. So make sure you keep us informed, question what we're talking about, and make sure you talk to your friends and neighbors. I am Darren Howard for the Reverend Earl and Neil Magnusen. It has been our privilege to bring you Radio Free Canada. Tune in Mock Harper Monday coming up 10 days from now. We'll be back. Have a great revolution.